Welcome to International Program for Islamic Economics and Finance, Faculty of Economics and Business, Universitas Muhammadiyah Yogyakarta. We are the first international program for Islamic Economics and Finance in Indonesia. It is a full-time program with the length of study around 3 to 4 years. International program. We provide outstanding skills both for theoretical and practical application of Islamic economics and finance.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Welcome to the International Program for Islamic Economic and Finance, Faculty of Economic and Business, Universitas Muhammadiyah Yogyakarta. This program aims at promoting toward reputable international program on Islamic Economic and Finance in ASEAN by 2021.
The study is conducted in the comfortable class and through interactive learning process. IPF provides the best facilities for the students to get the international exposure, such as providing good environment and using English to communicate in every learning process. IPF is supported by teaching staffs who graduated from top universities around the world with their excellent international achievements.
IPF is aimed at the following objectives. First, to facilitate students in attending the Islamic virtues. The second is to set up capacity building of graduates. And the last, to provide graduates in Islamic economics and finance equipped with ability and good qualification as well as English language proficiency.
In response to achieve the excellence of the students, IPF also support the students with a community to learn about public speaking, organization, discussion, and trainings to enhance soft skills of the students that not studied inside the class.
Hello everyone, my name is Muhammad Fikri Mohyudi. And ladies, to enhance sport and art division.
Today is my great honor to be here. Now let me briefly introduce myself to you. I come from China and my major is finance, but I'm staying in UMY. I belong to IPIEF. I have learned a lot of knowledge from the Islamic financial system.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. สวัสดีค่ะดิฉันนางสาวไมซาระสามแอมาจากประเทศไทยนะคะ I'm IPF alumni 2011. I was graduate from IPF on June 2016. I am very grateful to be a part of IPF because in IPF I got so many experience, knowledge, so many experience and good lecture and a lot of friends. After I'm graduate from IPF, I directly to got master degree scholarship from Indonesia government to continue my study in Universitas Gadjah Mada.
For all of you who want to study and learn about Islamic economic and finance, let's come and join with IPF. Let we together move toward international and reputable program on Islamic finance in Indonesia and the world. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Siapa tuh, nak? this program is quite interesting and very impactful because these programs invited so many renowned and international scholars around the world. And here we focus on the Islamic social finance and SDGs, not only for Indonesian case, but also for the world.
It's wonderful to be here in this exciting event, Summer School, Second International Training for Young Islamic Economic Leaders, Al-Quran, Science and Civilizational Renewal, Integration and Quality Assurance, Universitas Muhammadiyah Yogyakarta.
So once again, and by everything, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Hopefully, this event will be conduct smoothly, and we will get some benefit from this one.
So alhamdulillah, in IAUM, we managed to complete 10 textbooks the last 2 years, but another 40 to 60 coming up at International Islamic University. And other universities like USM coming up with 6 textbooks in Kuis and in Kuala Lumpur. And also here in Imam Bonjol, in Surakarta, and we hope that University Muhammadiyah Jogja will come up with any book with the number of resources that we have over here. So I hope based on this conference, more work can be done to improve the teaching and learning of Islamic economy. Thank you very much.
Berharap ke depannya event Summer School ini akan makin berkembang dan makin memberi impact yang lebih besar kepada para peserta.
I'm very happy to be with this program. I believe that the idea of developing young minds is very important for the future development of Islamic economics, not only in discipline but also in practice.
First of all, I would like to express my happiness in having you all in the third international conference on Islamic economics and financial inclusion. Welcome to our campus, Universitas Muhammadiyah Yogyakarta.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Saya Adi Warman Karim. Ini acara keren banget. Ini mesti dibuat lebih gede lagi tiap tahunnya biar lebih banyak lagi orang dapat manfaat dari acara ini. Nanti saya akan sampaikan Islamic Social Finance yang kita kaitkan dengan SDGs. Kita ingin berusaha memberikan, mengangkat ilmu-ilmu Islam dan kita tularkan ke semua teori-teori yang ada di dunia sehingga kita insya Allah umat Islam Indonesia bisa mewarnai dunia dengan pemikiran-pemikiran Islam.
Pada kesempatan kali ini dalam Forum International Conference yang diselenggarakan oleh IPF ya, Universitas Muda Yogyakarta, saya akan menyampaikan materi tentang Lajismo and SDGs, prospects and policies.
Thank you very much. I hope the organizer and the university will flourish and again to organize in this kind of conference in near future. Thank you very much.
I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to share my paper on integration of Islamic microfinance with Waqf. And we had presented a model which is being practiced by our Center for Islamic Economics, basically called ITAJIF, which is in collaboration with the CIMB Islamic in Malaysia.
It's a good opportunity for me to attend this conference, the third conference in Islamic Economic and Financial Inclusion. And it's a good opportunity for me also to bring my paper in this discussion, especially to link between Islamic finance and SDG.
Acara seminar internasional ini sangat bermanfaat ya bagi kalangan akademisi, kalangan mahasiswa untuk meningkatkan pengetahuannya, meningkatkan kualitas tulisannya khususnya tentang ekonomi keuangan syariah.
First, let me congratulate the organizing committee for choosing a topic that is very relevant today. As we know, in 2015, the United Nations formulated the 17 Sustainable Development Goals, whose idea is to bring people, planet, and prosperity together.
Acara ini sangat bagus, ya, terutama ketika topik-topiknya itu adalah sangat relevan pada zaman sekarang, dan topik-topik yang dibawa adalah topik-topik terhangat.
This agenda is very very delightful, great, and it's very worth for me and also for other participants because in 5 days, 8 to 8, we have many knowledge from the great speakers from overseas, and we know about Islamization of knowledge in other world also. For the committee, I also say thanks very much because you are very strong for 5 days here and also very very good to serve us as a participant.
So first of all, Alhamdulillah, because I got the Best Paper Awards. Although I got the Best Paper Award, it doesn't mean the other participants, their paper is not best. All the participants, did their best, okay? So for me, Alhamdulillah, is a kind of the reward from Allah SWT because give me this opportunity to come here, present my idea. Alhamdulillah, my idea is appreciated and also somehow is given some kind of the incentive for my papers.
Finally, I am personally, as director, want to express sincere thanks and appreciation to all of the parties that have contributed much to the success of this event. May Allah bless us and always give us health and iman. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Halo.
Halo.
Halo. Mr. Ronald?
Ya. Yeah.
How are you today?
Alhamdulillah great.
Alhamdulillah alamin. Yes. Hope that always in a good health today. While coronavirus spreading in all over the world. this is from your office?
No, it's in my house.
Yes, because during pandemic we promised to work from our home, right? Yes.
Yeah, indeed.
Yeah. Okay, there are already with 19 participants today, and I promise to you that we will start in this time.
Okay, sure.
Okay.
Okay, sure.
Yes. Okay, guys. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Yeah. Today is a special Thursday because in this afternoon I will discuss with Mr. Ronald. He is from Indonesian Deposit Insurance Company. That will discuss with all of you and me also about the management risk, especially Syariah banking risk, and what the regulation to regulate our Syariah banking. Pak Ronald, you will explain about the risk management in general, or only at the Syariah banking?
No, it's I will focus more on the Islamic banking or the Syariah banking.
And the regulation you will talk about in Indonesia that's conducted by OJK?
No, actually it's more than from international standard perspective from Basel Committee for Banking Supervision and Islamic Financial Services Board.
Okay, and it is a very nice when the participant here will compare what the regulation in Indonesia and in their country, right? Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, because we only have a limited time for about 1.5 hours. So I think it is better that we will start this discussion. Okay, guys. Let's be together listening the special speech, special material of the risk banking, especially on Islamic banking, and also regulation, yeah, by ourselves. And please, I give you about 20 to 30 minutes, Pak Ronald.
Okay.
Okay, yes, okay, time is yours.
Okay, thank you so much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon, everyone. Ms. Lilis, can you help me to, share the screen for my slide? Because I cannot manage from my tab. Okay, everyone. In this occasion, first of all, I would like to say thank you for the Department of Economics, University Muhammadiyah Yogyakarta. To invite for inviting me to share my talk and experience on this related issue in risk management. Basically, I need to introduce myself for some participant maybe who are not know me yet, or maybe some of us do not know each other yet. My name is Ronald Rulindo. Currently, I work in the Islamic Deposit Insurance Corporation, or Indonesian we call it as a Lembaga Penjamin Simpanan or LPS, as a coordinator for Islamic Economic and Islamic Finance Task Force. Last year, I was seconded to Komite Nasional Keuangan Syariah as a director for its innovation, product innovations, financial market deepening, and strengthening and Islamic finance infrastructure development. But prior to that, I mean, prior to 2013, I worked in Islamic Financial Services Board, which is an international standard setting body for Islamic financial services industry, including for Islamic bank, capital markets, and Islamic capital market and takaful sectors. Then in Islamic Financial Services Board, they produce a standard called as a risk management standard. In this moment, I would like to share a little bit later on an overview about the standard on how Islamic banks should manage or how risk in Islamic banks should be regulated or managed by the Islamic banks. Okay, you may go to the next slide. I assume that participants for these workshops have at least basic knowledge on Islamic finance, right? So maybe I don't need to go into detail on the theories part. Next slide, please. Okay, but in general, of course, we understand that Islamic finance refers to financial activities conducting through variety financial contracts that comply with Sharia rules and principles. And maybe next slide, yes. Next, okay, next. Basically, when we talk about Islamic banks and conventional banks, many people say that Islamic bank and conventional banks are really the same. To some extent, yes, because Islamic bank and conventional banks are financial intermediations. They collect money from those who have more funds, and then they channel it to those who need a fund. But the basic concept of conventional bank, you can go through until the end of this slide. Yeah, the basic contract used in the conventional bank is a loan with interest. So it is not Sharia compliance, by the way. But because in this modern time, the presence of a bank is necessary, and it's become necessity. Then the ulama come out with a model of Islamic bank in which still a financial intermediation, but the business models are different. So in the Islamic banks, next slide, please. In the Islamic banks, the banks collect deposit or investment from the client, still collect deposit or investment from the communities or for the people, but they merely use what's so-called wadiah and mudarabah contract. I believe most of you have understand about this, but then they channel the money used for the various type of akad like murabaha, mudarabah, ijarah, salam, istisna, and so on and so forth. From that, they got profit on share, profit from sales, profit sharing, ujrah, and then from all of the profit, they will distribute back as profit sharing to the mudarabah investment account holders, and then as a hibah for those who put their money in Islamic bank based on the wadiah contract. I'm not sure if I'm not mistaken, there are some participants that are not from Indonesia. They are from Malaysia. But for your information, Islamic banks in Indonesia is still, I mean, one step behind Islamic bank from the Malaysia. We still use mudarabah as a deposit. In fact, it's not really meet the theory in which mudarabah should treat as an investment account, which has been, I mean, converted in Malaysia since the issuance of Islamic Financial Service Act in 2013. But this model, maybe next slide first. Next slide. And I believe all of you are familiar as well with this type of contract. So just go to the next slide. The various type of contracts, and this contract can be put into, can be used as to structure many products of Islamic bank, which is in the liability side, and in financing or investment side. Next slide. Okay, still a glance on this. For wadiah, people put the money in the banks and as a custody, and then bank channel the money into the to the financings. But there is no guaranteed return here. But Islamic bank, based on its discretion, can give an hibah or bonus to the clients because the banks is allowed to use the money to as a financing. And then for the mudarabah, next, okay, oh, Still, yeah. Next, Mudaraba. The main difference with the Mudaraba and Wadiah. Just go directly to the next slide. Okay, the main difference with Wadiah and Mudaraba is Wadiah is a custody, while Mudaraba is, from the theory perspective, is a investment. Client put the money into the Islamic bank and let Islamic bank to invest the money. But there are two types of Mudaraba or what so-called investment account. I mean, here, first is the restricted investment account. Second one is unrestricted investment account. In the unrestricted investment account, the investor do not provide specific instruction to the bank to which kind of investment that the money to be invest with. But for the restricted investment account, the Islamic the investor give some restrictions and they identify some kind of investment, then Islamic bank put their money into that account. Okay, I still highlight these two type of the source of fund in an Islamic bank because it affect the risk of it, especially liquidity risk in Islamic banks later on. Next slide. Okay, we can go too fast. Yeah, I believe most of you already understand Murabaha, but when I talk Murabaha here, I mean, we always have to go back to the basic theory that in Murabaha, bank have to buy the asset first and then sell it to the customer with cost plus markup or profit margin. Okay, that's how the Murabaha is structured. Next slide. Ijarah is somehow have similarity with Murabaha, but Ijarah actually still bank buy the asset and then lend it to the customer. And the end of the period, the bank can give the asset to the customer as an hiba, or they can sell it with a cheaper price. But during the lease period, the asset is owned by the Islamic bank. So this is the specific characteristic that we have to always put in mind because it's also trigger a risk in an Islamic bank that we will discuss later on. Next slide. Okay, this slide is personal financing, and maybe later on the Salam financing is almost similar, which is as financing in which the asset is not ready yet. So the customer will ask for Islamic bank to provide them a certain kind of asset for the existing customer. They request Islamic bank to come out with a certain product that has to be built first. But for the Salam financing, it most likely has to be grown first, because for the Salam financing, most likely the asset is the kind of agricultural product such as crop and something like that. And then the bank will find a contractor, for example, in Istisna to develop the products, and they also give assistance now financing to the contractor, and after the contractor finish the product, the bank will sell the asset to the initial customer. Similarly with the Salam is also like that, but the main difference is in the Salam, the profit the cost is paid in a full amount in the beginning. Well, in Istisna, the cost can be paid into different stage. Okay, this also trigger of specific risk let alone to the Islamic bank. Next slide. Okay, we can go on because I have discussed this slide already. Next. Okay, next we talk about Mudarabah, and later on the next slide is Musyarakah. So basically Mudarabah and Musyarakah have similarities. The thing is in Mudarabah, Mudarabah, there's only, I mean, the investment managers do not need to put the money into the ventures. In Mudarabah, there is investor and there is a there's a customer here as the investment manager. So they put the money together to build a venture. So if there is a profit, the profit will share according to the profit sharing ratio, agreed profit sharing ratio. But if there's a loss, it will be borne by the bank as investor. Differently, next slide, with the Musyarakah. Musyarakah, both customer and the bank put the money into a venture. So if there is a profit and loss, they will share together based on the agreed profit sharing ratio. Next slide, please. Okay, just go to next slide. Okay, we go to the main issues now. With different business model between Islamic banks and conventional banks, the balance sheet structure of Islamic bank will be also different as compared to the conventional banks. In the liability side, for example, we can find what so called as equity of profit sharing investment account in the maybe it's not liability side. In Indonesia, we call it as a credit side, right? We said it is a debit and credit. But in the credit side of the balance sheet, usually in a normal company, they only have liability and owner's equity. But in Islamic bank, they have equity of profit sharing investment account. Okay, this profit sharing investment account reflect the money that Islamic bank collect from the investment account or from the instrument, funding instrument based on the mudarabah. But in asset side, in conventional bank, we can only find what's so called as loan. But here in Islamic bank, we structure it more detail based on the akad that we use for the financing. For murabaha, it triggered the what's so called as sales receivable. But for mudarabah, it's different. It could be equity in joint ventures or musyarakah, equity in capital venture for or equity in investment in joint venture for mudarabah and musyarakah. But for the ijarah, it can be investment in lease asset. It could be lead to inventory as well. And for the salam and istisna also it can lead to inventory, something like that. So it trigger it make a different style of balance sheet between Islamic banks. Here IFSB always say this and IFS, but make it simple as Islamic bank. IFS refer to institution offering Islamic financial services. Okay, but then actually it's not only from balance sheet perspective that make that's a difference between Islamic bank and conventional banks. It trigger another potential issues because including in risk management, because how Islamic bank should manage the financing due to different characteristics of akad could be different if we compare not only to the risk management in conventional banks but also to the risk management for different type of Islamic type of financing. Next slide. That's why if we go back to the IFSB standard, okay, they are not only focused on the risk management only. Risk management is the IFSB one, is the first standard introduced by the IFSB. But after provide a guidance how Islamic bank should manage risk within the bank, IFSB also come out with a standard on capital adequacy. Because according to Basel Committee for Banking Supervision, or BCBS. BCBS is a committee under the BIS, Bank for International Settlement. BIS is kind of association of central banks. Most likely in the world, central banks are at the same time are regulators for the banking sector as well. In Indonesia, since 2011, we established an OJK, so the regulators for the banks, banking sector is taking out from the central banks. But the BIS, I mean, as the association of the regulators, they established the BCBS. The BCBS issued a standard, which is we call as a capital adequacy, normally called as a Basel 1, Basel 2, Basel 3, and so on and so forth. One point that they regulate is about the capital adequacy. Because bank collects money from the customer, okay, they have to manage the money properly. To ensure that they manage the money properly, the bank should should provide a guarantee, so-called as guarantee, in form of the minimum capital requirement. So IFSB also talk about the capital adequacy standards. But still, when we regulating the risk, it's not only limited to the risk management and capital adequacy, but how the bank itself is governed That is also regulated by the IFSB. IFSB issued corporate governance standards, and that later on they also issued a Sharia governance standard, because there are also what so called as Sharia non-compliance risks, which I will explain later on, that should also manage properly by Islamic Bank as well. So after manage the risk, put a capital against the risk, and ensure good corporate governance within the banks, the Islamic Bank is also forced to provide some kind of transparency and disclosure to promote market discipline, because after the after strict regulation and supervision, the BCBS also promote what so called as market discipline. Let the market discipline the bank, in which the bank has to disclose how much NPL, non-performing loan or the non-performing financing that they have, and let people know that this bank is healthy or not. If the bank is not healthy, okay, the depositors can decide to go to another bank, which is a healthier bank, for example. And then the IFSB also provide a guidance on how supervisor, in Indonesia is OJK, but in Malaysia is Bank Negara Malaysia, has to supervise the Islamic Bank. But for this moment, I will talk more on the risk management perspective only. Next slide. Go next slide. Okay, this is the basic theory of the risk management. Risk management process consists of risk identification, in which we have to identify what kind of risk that exists in the bank or in a specific transaction. Most likely in the bank, we know that there are credit risk, liquidity risk, market risk, and operational risk. So first of all, the banks will identify in all aspects of the organization, including in the giving financing, is there any credit risk there? Okay, if yes, they go to the next step. They do the risk assessment and risk measurement. Somehow people mix these things up, yeah. But of course, we will start with the risk assessment first. We have to determine the potential impacts of this potential occurrence or frequency, potential frequency of the risk, which is high, low, medium, and so on and so forth. And then we determine whether this risk has a high impact, medium impact, or low impact. Usually, company, including Islamic Bank, they will draw a matrix, frequency and likelihood. Frequency or likelihood or impact. Okay. From then, they will decide what they will do for the next step, how to manage the risk or how. No. Go back. We still stop in this slide. They will decide what kind of risk mitigating technique or risk management technique that have to be done for some kind of risk. For example, the bank can outsource the risk if they say that, oh, I mean, the risk is is so big for us, it's not match our risk appetite. The Islamic Bank can ask a takaful company to take some of the risk, to share the risk with the takaful company. But if the risk is still manageable, okay, the bank will decide some kind of risk mitigation that they will undertake. Or if the risk is low, it's something that will happen actually, the bank will just accept the risk. And then after that, all the risk will be monitored day to day by the banks, and it has to be report and control to the senior management as well as to the board directors, in which in Indonesia we adopt the two-tier corporate governance system. We have a board of commissioner and board of director, alias Dewan Komisaris and Dewan Direksi. So this risk management process should be applied in all Islamic banks, but of course the implementation is depend on the scope, complexity, and nature and activities of the banks. What does it mean by the scope? It depend on the size of, for example, of the Islamic banks activity as well. It also depend on the complexity of the Islamic bank activity as well, and of course the nature of such activities. Because we cannot say that, oh, if the bank is a big Islamic bank, they should have more comprehensive risk management rather than small Islamic banks. Or full-fledged Islamic bank should have more comprehensive risk management process than the Islamic banking windows. That's not to some extent, yes, that may be true, but to another extent, maybe not, because there is possibility that Islamic banking windows has more complex transaction than the big Islamic bank, than the full-fledged Islamic bank. For example, Indonesia, we have a Maybank Islamic, Maybank Syariah, we have CIMB Niaga Syariah. In term of size, it's much bigger than Bank Victoria Syariah, for example, of Bank Jabar Banten Syariah or BJB Syariah. So the risk management process in the Islamic banking windows of the Maybank Syariah and Islamic CMB Syariah should much better than the small full-fledged Islamic banks. Next slide. Next. Okay. In the previous slide, I explained about the basic concept of risk management process. But when we go to the international best practice or international guidance provided BCBS, they provide a lot of guidance on the risk management. If you want to check the website, just go to BIS. Just search in Google, actually. They provide a guidance in the website by the BIS, but just go to the page of BCBS. And in terms of risk and governance, the BCBS provide a guidance on internal control system, compliance principles, and they also discuss about risk concentrations, intra-group transaction for the big banks, capital planning, banking supervision. But for a specific risk, they talk about credit risk, market risk, liquidity risk, interest rate risk, and operational risk. We will talk about these risks later on. For the more advanced bank, for the big bank, for example, especially for the international active bank, they will discuss about they will provide the guidance as well. They provide the guidance as well about the counterparty credit risk, off balance sheet exposure, derivative, and so on and so forth. And then they also provide guidance about risk management and infrastructure. For example, how is banks should come out with internal rating system, how they do risk integration and aggregation, how the bank should do the risk modeling and conduct stress testing, and so many issues that we can explore, and perhaps we have another time, maybe we can discuss one specific issues in much more detail. But now let me go next slide to the specific issues in Islamic banks. We can find a similar risk in an Islamic bank as compared to the conventional banks, like credit risk, market risk, operational risk, and liquidity risk. But somehow, although definition of the risk, although definition of the risk to some extent are similar, maybe I will explain a little bit for those who doesn't know yet, do not have a good understanding about definition or cannot differentiate the difference between this risk. Credit risk is a risk that occurs due the client are not able to fulfill their obligations. In other words, they cannot pay back the loan. Okay, that's what so-called as credit risk. Market risk in the risk of a loss occurs due to the change to the volatility of a price of an asset that we own. Most likely it's like a bond or stock or shares and an asset, okay, that normally have the benchmark price in the market, or maybe currency as well, currency. So if, for example, if Islamic bank, they have liability in US dollars next month, for example, today how much rupiah today to dollar, for example, now rupiah to dollar, for example, is just 14,000. But if the bank have liabilities in US dollars next month, but then the US dollars to rupiah next month is 15,000, so the Islamic bank will lose 1,000. Okay, that's what so called as the market risk. And then operational risk is risk due to people process system and external event. For example, if there are fraud, okay, if there are fraud, and then the bank lost due to the fraud, or maybe some kind of system error, okay, or maybe an external event, for example, flood or earthquake. And liquidity risk is a risk in which the banks are not able to pay back to fulfill its obligation to the customer. In simple words, the bank when the customer want to take back the money from the bank, the bank has not enough cash to pay back the client's money. Okay, so the same definition more or less are applied to the Islamic banks, but there are some different aspect, different consequence because of the different account that we use in an Islamic bank. I hope you still remember when we talked about the murabah in the beginning, that the bank has to buy the asset first, okay? Bank has to buy the asset first and sell it to the customer. For example, if we want to get a car financing, we want to buy a car, but we don't have enough money. So we go to the bank and tell the bank we want to buy a car and we want to get a financing from the bank. Still the previous slide, okay? So you tell the bank about the car, identify the car, and the bank will buy the car for you. And then later on, they will sell it to you. But if we follow this theory, the sequence of the akad properly, when the bank buy the car, okay, so meaning that the bank own the asset. So, but then, if the client say that, oh, I cancel my plan, I don't want to buy the car from you, okay, I don't want to buy the car from the banks. So the bank hold a market risk only, okay. They own the car, they have the market risk because they have the asset. Why market risk? Because there is possibility that when the bank sell again the car to other parties, the price of the car could be reduced or could be decreased. So there is potential loss there. But if the customer do not cancel the transaction, the car sold by the bank to the customer, so market risk will disappear. The bank then own the credit risk in case the customer cannot fail to pay back the loan or the financing to the bank. This is what we call as transformation of risk. These are not exist in the conventional banks. So these things also later on affect on how bank, Islamic bank should determine their capital, minimum capital requirements. That example of the murabaha. Different cases we found in salam transactions. When the bank give a salam financing, meaning that they ask a farmer to cultivate some kind of crop, for example, padi, for example, or rice, okay? The bank own the credit risk and market risk at the same time. If the farmer experience fail, if the agriculture is failed, meaning that the farmer cannot deliver the crops to the Islamic bank. But that's why there are credit risk there. But if the customer success in delivering the crops, but the price of the crops at the time of delivery is lower in the market, so the ultimate customer or the ultimate buyer can just cancel the contracts and they go to the farmer to the market to buy the crops. So now the banks own the market risk. See, this is the combination of a risk experienced by the bank due to the salam contracts. So both of these things also applicable later on when we calculate the minimum capital requirements of the Islamic banks to compensate this kind of risk. Next slide. Okay, we talked about credit risk, market risk, liquidity risk, and operational risk. But there are another specific risk to the Islamic banks. First, it is a equity investment risk. Actually, equity investment risk is a risk due to Islamic bank giving mudarabah or musyarakah financing. Okay. To some extent, equity investment risk is similar to the credit risk. For example, if the clients of them or the investment manager that receive the mudarabah or musyarakah financing experience failure in the business, so they cannot pay back the loan, the financing to the bank. Then Islamic bank will experience capital impairment risk, which to some extent are similar to the credit risk. But the thing is, how about if the investment? How if the investment managers still still generate profit, but the profit is not up to the expectation of the bank at the beginning when they disburse or when they give the mudaraba or musyarakah financing. We cannot classify that as a market risk. That's why there is a new term here we call as a equity investment risk. This is one of the example of the equity investment risk. But in fact, when we talk about equity investment risk, means that if Islamic bank involved in this risk, they involved with all the risk associated with the ventures. That's the equity investment risk. Second, we go to the rate of return risk. In the conventional bank, it may be to some extent similar to the interest rate risk in the banking book, which somehow also classified as a market risk. But there are some significant similarities between rate of return risk and interest rate risk in a banking book. Because in the interest rate risk in a conventional bank, meaning that when the bank receive a saving with a, for example, the banks accumulate saving and promise the customer to give them a low interest 8%, for example. But then the bank just disburse the financing and charge interest to the customer 12%. Then the bank will receive a spread positive 4%, right? The thing is, how about if the economy getting worse and then interest rate increase? In the conventional bank, they easily increase the interest rate from 8% to 10%, for example. And in the financing side, they can increase the interest rate from 12% to 14%. So they still manage to get a spread by 4%. But the same thing, it cannot be applied in Islamic bank. Because in Islamic bank, in the credit side, they accumulate fund based on the mudarabah principle, investment principles. So in the investment, in the financing side, Islamic bank use various type of contract. We already discussed about murabaha, salam, istisna, ijarah, and mudarabah and musyarakah. As we know, when Islamic bank provide a murabaha financing, the cost plus markup or the cost of financing is fixed already. It cannot be changed. So if the interest rate risk in the liability side or for the saving is increased, the bank cannot charge the additional profit margin to the clients. It's fixed already. Same case happened to the salam and istisna. Only in ijarah, Islamic bank can adjust the rental rate, but in practice, we are rarely seeing some kind of implementation. Okay. In mudarabah and musyarakah, it's even worse because Islamic bank will get a return based on the past performance of the client. So if interest rate increase, it's not necessarily that the profit sharing of the mudarabah or musyarakah venture will be increased. So the Islamic bank cannot give a higher, cannot change the rate of return, increase the so-called interest rate to the clients in the credit side. What they can do is they can sacrifice some of the income, okay? They can sacrifice some of the income and pay it to the customer. This activity called as a smoothing profit. But if the bank do the smoothing profit, meaning that they will experience the next net income will be decreased, okay? The possibility that the net income of Islamic bank decrease because they do the profit smoothing called as rate of return risk. And rate of return risk create a displaced commercial risk because net income at the end of the day will be distributed as dividend to the shareholders, right? But because of the bank undertake the profit smoothing, meaning that some dividends that has to be received by the shareholders, they are failed to receive the same amount of the original dividend because they already assume the risk that should be assumed originally by the investor. So the shareholder, the risk is displaced here. They're displaced. They're supposed to be assumed by the investor, but then it's assumed by the shareholders. That's what so-called as displaced commercial risk. And then when we talk about the operational risk, Normally, there are many type risk that can be categorized as operational risk. For example, legal risk, strategic risk, and many things. But in Islamic Bank, there are new type, new additional type of risk which are Sharia non-compliance risk and fiduciary risk. In Sharia non-compliance risk, Sharia compliance risk is the possibility of the banks fail to meet the Sharia rules and principles. Okay, it's a nice thing to debate about Sharia non-compliance risk, but maybe we can debate about it later on. And then there are fiduciary risk. Fiduciary risk is referred to the risk that Islamic Bank failed to meet its obligation to the investment account holders. Bu Lilis, how many minutes that I have?
Yeah, you have 3 minutes more, Pak.
Okay. So maybe this next slide I will not role of board directors I cannot explain in detail because we have limited time, but you are welcome if you want to know more about that later on. Next slide. But I think I need more than 3 minutes. I hope you are kind enough to give me more time. So, next slide. Okay, this is important here. And how the Islamic Bank manage the credit risk? First, they should have strategy of strategy of financing, considering various type of Islamic financing instruments and stage of contract. We know that we Islamic Bank have a murabahah, mudarabah financing, salam financing, ijarah financing, istisna financing. So the bank should have strategy to what kind of customer that murabahah financing should be given. Can the mudaraba and musyaraka financing, for example, can be given to the micro in the form of micro financing? And now that kind of question should be answered by the bank first and put in the strategy of financing that that they have. That's the first thing. The second thing is similar to the conventional bank, the Islamic bank should also conduct due diligence review prior deciding appropriate Islamic type of financing that will be given to certain kind of customer. But different to the due diligence in a conventional bank, in Islamic bank, the due diligence should cover the Sharia compliance aspect as well. Sharia compliance due diligence. For example, let's say that the business of the banks is Sharia compliance, but to some extent, the potential clients somehow are not really preferable from Sharia perspective. For example, in Malaysia, we have a genting company, I can't remember the full name of this group, but they have many business tourism, including a gambling center. I mean, very big in Singapore and in Malaysia. So if I'm not mistaken, Islamic Bank hesitant to give financing to the genting, even for the business that actually are not comply to the Sharia. Okay, and then next, develop risk measurement and risk reporting that recognize specificities of Islamic financing instruments. You still remember transformation of risk and combination of risk that I mentioned earlier. So Islamic Bank should have a risk measurement framework that can catch such kind of specificities as well. And of course, Islamic Bank should have a Sharia compliant risk mitigating technique as well. For example, Urbun and Hamis Jediah, and then third party guarantees. Maybe if we have enough time, I will explain one by one in detail. So the principle in managing credit risk is also applicable to the equity investment risk. But there are more things that have to be done related to equity investment risk. Okay, first, Islamic Bank should have clear reason why they give the equity investment financing. They should understand the risk characteristic of the venture that they involve with. They should know the cash flow from the company and maybe the seasonalities of the income. It's important to set expectation of profit required from the financing. And other than that, Islamic Bank also have a clear value, have a valuation established valuation method considering specific characteristic of equity instrument, so that because Islamic bank and the venture will define the profit based on that agreed profit sharing ratio. So they should know some tricks by the ventures if they want to hide the profit. Okay, be careful because somehow the clients will try to decrease the profit and increase their cost so that they will give the minimum return to the banks.
This is somehow time is over. This is a Venice. Maybe we can continue with our discussion at the part two, right?
Okay.
You feel not yet enough.
Can I add more minutes because I'm afraid that the participant will not go. I mean, we don't discuss about Sharia non-compliance risk first, liquidity risk first. Equity risk, it's also important. Okay.
Okay. What time that you you will?
Under 10 minutes, for example.
Oh, yes. Okay. Time is yours.
Okay. Yeah. And related to the equity investment risk, the bank should also have exit strategies when they have to quit from the ventures because different to the normal partnership, the bank will not be with the partnership for forever. So the Islamic bank should have clear exit strategies. With the equity investment financing. With regard to market risk, maybe I will not discuss in detail due to the time constraints. Other than that, Islamic Bank in Indonesia has not much exposure on the market risk as well. But Islamic Bank still have to be careful, especially if they buy, if they provide ijarah financing, they own that asset. So in that case, Islamic Bank should be aware that they exposed to market risk as well for the certain kind of financing. Next slide. Okay, so now about liquidity risk. And when we talk about liquidity risk, I try to simplify what Islamic bank should do. They should calculate cash outflow and cash inflow. So they will know how much cash that they need every month. So when we calculate cash inflow, they have to be careful with the specific characteristic of the akad because cash inflow can come from the new customer or from the installment paid by the bank's customer who receive financing for example for murabaha musyarakah mutanakisah that's a fixed return, so that's a predictable cash flow. But for the salam and istisna, it's predictable but conditional cash flow. But for the mudarabah and musyarakah, it's a unpredictable and unconditional, so it's a little bit difficult to predict the cash flow from such kind of instrument. And from cash outflow, be aware with the behavior of the client, especially for the mudarabah investment account holders. Okay, for the current account, for example, for the clients with the wadiah who put the money in the bank based on the wadiah, maybe the behavior are not really different to the current account customer in the conventional banks. And then after they identify the liquidity gap, Islamic Bank should have a framework on how they manage such a liquidity. They should have availability Sharia compliant funding sources. It can come from the parent company, can come from the other Islamic banks, or can come from the central bank as lender of last resort. But of return risk, maybe it's also a very challenging issues. I mean, I will explain later on in detail if some of you ask about this, okay? But in managing rate of return risk, in some countries, they establish what so-called as profit equalization reserve. So if the banks experience high profit, okay, they will not distribute all profit to the customer, but they put it in the reserve. But when they have a lower profit as compared to the conventional bank, meaning that if the equivalent rate of deposit paid by the customer is lower than the interest rate paid by conventional bank, they can take the money from the profit equalization reserve to conduct the sputing profit. And maybe the last risk that I will discuss here is Sharia non-compliance risk. As I discussed earlier, Sharia non-compliance risk is the risk that bank fail to meet to comply with Sharia rules and principle. Is that possible as Islamic bank not following the Sharia rules and principle? Yes, it is. Because although we already have Dewan Syariah Nasional, we have the standard fatwa already we have DPS, Dewan Pengawas Syariah or Syariah Supervisory Board. In the beginning, from conceptual perspective, from the micro perspective, the banks is already comply with Syariah rules and principle. But somehow in the practice, it could be different. You can check with some of fraud case in Islamic Bank. If you remember the case of the Bank Syariah Mandiri Bogor branch, you know, they have high non-performing financing due to the murabahah transaction. It's a fraud. There's no real financing. But interestingly, it's not only in the BSM. In Bank Rakyat Indonesia, when there was still a unit usaha syariah or Windows, they also have the same problem. They give murabahah financing for host financing in which the host is not existed. So it's already not compliant to the Sharia, because when we talk about murabahah, the asset has to be ready. There are more issues here, and there are some guidance provided by IFSB in managing Sharia non-compliant risk, related, especially when we talk about Sharia governance. But maybe I will answer or I will explain later on in the question and answer session. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Ronald. You asked me to get more time, about 10 minutes, but I think that's it is less from the 10 minutes. Okay. Yeah. Okay, thank you very much for the nice presentation today and a valuable courses related to the Islamic banking or Syariah banking, risk management and regulation. Yeah. Yeah, as we know that this is a very different when we compare between Syariah banking and the conventional banking. So that's why we have the different regulation to risk management and maybe compliant, okay? And also that's why we couldn't say that Syariah banking not only the interest-free bank, but also Syariah banking is a bank which the operational based on Syariah principle. Yeah, so that's why this is have the different term with the conventional. But the society until now still have the perception that this is the same between Syariah and conventional banking. I think that's because the people or the society have not yet understanding about what the operational of the Syariah banking. So this is our obligation to make the people understand about the Syariah principle that's implemented in our Syariah banking. Okay, guys, I think this is a very nice and very interesting presentation by Pak Ronald, and I think you can read the question here. And this is the one question from Pak Dimas, Pak Ronald. The question is, in there any standard principle? Dimas asked that on balance between risk and stability. In there any standard principle by international body standard so that Islamic banking can remain resilient in whatever conditions?
Okay.
Yeah.
When we talk about risk and stability, actually is the standard that talk about risk and stability is this standard, actually the FSB 1 risk management standard. But later on, if we in the FSB, they also issued another standard. I can't remember exactly, it's FSB 12 or FSB 13. First talk about the liquidity risk management, and then the next one talk about the stress testing management. But when we want to balance risk and stability, I mean, this standard talk about the process of managing risk and something and so on and so forth. But to maintain the stability, it really depends on the risk appetite of the board of the directors itself. I mean, if you can go back to the slide, I mean, I have a diagram there. Maybe you can open again my slide. Okay. In the slide, I put some information provided by the IFSB about the what the board of directors should do. Yeah, go back. Yes, this one. Next. All the risk is there. There's a table. This one. Okay. So the board of directors that has to balance the risk and the stability, because it is their duty to approve risk management objectives, strategies, policy, and procedures. They are the one who have to set the risk appetite. I'll give you an example. For the banks like Bank Syariah Mandiri, BNI Syariah, or maybe BCA Syariah, I think the risk appetite is low. Okay, they don't want to go to the very high risk type of financing. But different case with the Victoria Syariah, for example, because they are small banks. Okay, so the problem with a small bank is they have a expensive source of fund, high cost of fund. So they are forced to give a high cost of financing as well. When they give high cost of financing, of course, high risk, high return, right? Yes. So if they want high returns, meaning that there are high risk as well. So risk appetite in a smaller bank must be bigger than the risk appetite of the big bank. So it is board of directors that need that will balance between the risk and stability. But different case happened to the BTPN Syariah. BTPN Syariah is a microfinance bank. I think it is the only Islamic bank that provide a microfinancing based on the Grameen model in Indonesia. They give financing to newly enterprise, the poor people, okay? But they use the group lending mechanism. They have very beautiful risk management techniques by using group lending and based on weekly meeting and then based on training. So this is the role of the board of director that come out with a risk management objective and strategies to policies and procedure to minimize the risk. But of course, the senior management, meaning that the group head and then the senior manager and so on and so forth, make sure that policy and procedure are well implemented. So, and then board of directors should also establish the risk management structure function and also compliance function, audit function to ensure that all of this process or all the risk management process are do well actually. That's from the bank's point of view. But then to manage stability is not only the concern of the bank itself. Of course, the bank will concern more on the profitability. So it will be the concern of the supervisors. That's why IFSB come out with the standard on supervisory review process in which the supervisors will put certain limits to the activities of the banks, including in Islamic banks. Okay. They introduce some ratios to minimize risk in the bank. For example, the gross NPL are not allowed to be more than 5%. If it is more than 5%, there are some punishment, for example, from the central bank and for the regulators. And then in terms of capital adequacy that I mentioned earlier, since the last 20 years, banks adopt the Basel risk-weighted asset to calculate the capital adequacy of a bank. So if bank who has more risky asset, they need to provide more capital. That's how the governments, the central bank or regulators manage risk and stability in the banking industry, including an Islamic bank. I think that's for me now. Of course, there are more to explain, but I saw that some people ask a new question, another question.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Pak Ronald. How about Dimas? You satisfied with this answer from Pak Ronald? Hello, Pak Dimas. Yeah. Okay. I think you feel so satisfied with the explanation by Pak Ronald. Yeah. The second question, Pak Ronald. This is a very interesting question for you. Okay. Come from Novilia Aisa from the Magister Management Program Fakultas Ekonomi and Business Jember University, Universitas Jember, Jawa Timur. Okay. The first questions. How about the risk management in conventional banking which have subsidiaries? That's mean have the BUS and OUS, yeah. Is there any different way to hold the risk management? This is the first questions. The second question, how about DPS performance? It is work before a case or to solve after the risk on bad probability attack?
Thank you. It's a very interesting question.
Yes.
But first of all, we have to remember that risk has no religion. Risk has no religion. So in general, risk in the Islamic bank and conventional banks are the same. Okay. In general, risk in Islamic bank and conventional bank are the same. But of course, there are risks that specific to Islamic banks only. And also there are risks to the conventional bank that might not exist in Islamic bank because Islamic bank do not undertake such activities because it is prohibited according to the Sharia principle. So that's the big picture actually. But when we talk about BUS and UUS, is there any different in term of risk management? The answer is no actually. The answer is no. Is no because the activities are the same. If they give murabahah financing, murabahah financing, istisna financing, so the risk management framework will follow the activities of the Islamic bank, whether they are BUS, UUS, or even BPRS. So the difference is depends on, if we go back to my slide, previous slide. Not that one. Previous one. Yeah. No, I think it's before this. This one. Okay. It depends on this one. These things: scope, complexity, and nature of activities. There is possibility that UUS or Islamic Windows has more robust risk management framework as compared to the BUS or full-fledged Islamic bank. If the nature of Islamic financings are, of course, more complex. For example, I think CIMB Niaga Syariah and my bank Syariah, they have. I'm not sure, but I don't know in detail. But I'm pretty sure they have maybe a cross-border activities because their parent companies are in Malaysia. In that case, for sure that the risk management framework in these two Islamic windows has to be more complex than small bank like Victoria Syariah or BJB Syariah and so on and so forth. Okay, that's for the first question. The second question is about the Dewan Pengawas Syariah, how they can have a role in managing risk in Islamic banks. Actually, this question triggered. I have to explain about the Sharia governance related to this question. Sharia, when we talk about Sharia governance, governance itself is tata kelola in Indonesian language, right? Governance is how a company are run and managed appropriately to meet the shareholders' objective. But Sharia governance is a little bit different. Sharia governance is how the company or how the Islamic financial institution is managed and organized to ensure that this institution meet the Sharia rules and principles. So, there are few organs in Sharia governance. If we refer to the FSB standard, they only have three. First is the Sharia Supervisory Board or the Dewan Pengawas Syariah. And then they have a Sharia compliance function and a Sharia review or Sharia audit function. But in Malaysia, they require to have an Islamic financial institution, especially Islamic bank, to have more functions. Other than the DPS or the Sharia Supervisory Board, they require the banks to have a Sharia compliance or they call it a Sharia review, and then they have a Sharia audit, and then they require Islamic bank to have a Sharia risk management function and to have a Sharia research academy, if I'm not mistaken. So they put another two additional function related to Sharia and the Sharia government applied in Islamic banks in Malaysia. So when we talk about Sharia governance, there are what's so called as ex ante and ex post process. In ex ante process, this where the Sharia board or the DPS and the Sharia compliant functions play a role. Okay, so all the activities, I mean, if the banks have to, will come out with a Islamic finance new financing, for example, they have to go to the Sharia compliant function first. The Sharia compliant will check whether the activities are comply to with the Sharia or not. Okay, that's what so called as ex ante. Of course, in the ex ante one, there are fatwa and there are rules maybe from the DPS, and then Sharia compliance will report to DPS, and DPS will determine whether this transaction can be done or not. But of course, DPS only meet maybe once a month or twice a month. I'm not sure, and I don't know. Okay, so the function that play a significant role here is the Sharia compliance. But there is possibility that the Sharia compliant miss something. That's why the Sharia audit or the those who play in the ex ante process of afterward process play a significant role. They will check the Sharia compliant for the everything, you know, like a Sharia audit, like the internal audit. They will do the Sharia audit to ensure the process within the banks already meet the rules and the requirement from the compliance perspective. They will check whether the Sharia compliant function will do the job well, or is there any miss in the work that has been done. For example, if they miss, they use wrong akad for a certain kind of financing in other countries, for example in Pakistan, you know, the transaction is void. Even the return that has been generated from the transactions cannot be recognized as the income. It's different with what happened in Indonesia. We somehow are very lenient with that. But in other countries, they are very strict. Maybe because they are strict in implementing the Sharia compliance, Allah gives more barakah to them. That's why the asset of Islamic bank in those countries are much bigger than in Indonesia. I think that's my answer, Bu Lilis.
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much for the explanation. Yeah, I hopefully to Novia you satisfy with this explanation by Pak Ronald. Yeah, there are person Saiko Gasama will ask to you directly. Okay, okay, please Saiko Gasama, time is yours. You will speaking with the speaker.
Okay, thank you, Doctor, for giving me the opportunity. Thank you, Doctor, for the wonderful presentation. Very educative, and we've learned a lot in it. My name is Sigu Gasama from the Gambia, West Africa. Currently in Indonesia, here studying in the University of Erlangga, Masters in Accountancy. Growth of the depiction, you talked about like the slide before me. I think I have a question pertaining to that cycle or that process you've explained here. Mm-hmm. And although my sister Novili has asked a question that has a similarity with mine, but my question, I will just go specific. Like you talk about the risk mitigation process cycle here, the risk management process cycle here, and then among them you talked about the risk mitigation. Okay, so in the Islamic perspective, I know obviously that, you know, you give a response that, you know, risk has no religion, and I like that response. That's absolutely right. But how do we treat the risks? There the difference will come. For instance, here, if you talk about the credit risk, now, that credit risk, if you looked at it in conventional banking system, obviously, they will request what collateral or stuff like that. And that collateral, if you turn to be defaulted, obviously, they will use that collateral for sale in order to pay off their loan. But their transfer risk, which is, I don't think, is acceptable in Islamic. So I would like, you know, you to give us the aspect of Islamic aspect of it. Like, if do they use collateral? Did they require collateral from their, you know, customers? And if they do, what did they do about it in the case of default? Okay. Yeah, that's one of the question. And the other question has to do with the concept of stock. You talked about balance sheet as well in Islamic perspective, and then you elaborated the differences. And I've seen some of the items, though I'm not that much versed in the area, so I would like to seek your idea about that. You talk about a balance sheet and there you bring in the stock and then the assets. Now here, I just want to know specifically whether stock valuations there, what are the mechanisms? Is there any difference between Islamic perspective of it or and the conventional, like, you know, valuing the stock? Did they look at the market value or stuff like that? And how do you see that? And then asset also with regards to the depreciation and stuff like that, what those Islamic perspective deals with those things. Yeah, thank you, doctor. Those are the questions I have for you. I really appreciate, I learned a lot from the presentation. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi. Thank you so much, Brother Syekhu. Very interesting questions. Okay, when we talk about risk mitigation in Islamic banks, okay, there are some, yeah, first when we start first with the risk has no religion. Of course, the risk mitigation somehow could be the same between Sharia and conventional. But again, there are consequences of applying Islamic Islamic finance in the financial business, of course, because there is possibility that Sharia that risk mitigation somehow are not comply to the Sharia rules and principles. In the market risk, for example, there are derivatives, right? Many of the derivatives products are still not Sharia compliant yet. For example, original put options and call options. It consists of gharar and gambling there. That's why originally Islamic scholars or ulama do not approve the put option or call options, or maybe later on hedging, and then so many derivative product in the Islamic banks. So such derivative product are used to mitigate market risk in the conventional banks. This is also the reason for maybe that Islamic banks are not much advanced in market. In the products that content of the market risk, because they know that the risk mitigation for the market risk somehow are not available. That risk Sharia compliant risk mitigating technique for market risk somehow are not available. Okay, but for the credit risk, most likely different. Islamic bank also can also require collateral for the client. They can also request for the third party collateral, or they can also request for the urbun. Urbun is kind of a down payment, or hamis jidiyah. Hamis jidiyah, I'm not sure how to call it in English. Hamis jidiyah in Indonesia is tanda jadi. I mean, security deposit, yeah. So security deposit. But yes, it's true in some jurisdictions, there are different perspective about these risk mitigation techniques. For example, about hamis jidiyah or the securities deposit. In some countries, hamis jidiyah. In many countries, they accept that hamis jidiyah if the client, for example, in the murabahah financing, when you want to buy a car from the bank, you pay the hamis jidiyah, and then you cancel your plan, yeah, your plan. And you said to the bank, I don't want to buy the car, but in fact the bank has buy the car already. So the bank can take the hamis jidiyah. But some countries, when I was in the IFSB, I delivered a workshop in, I can't remember, is it in Bahrain or in Oman or in Dubai? They questions about that. They are, from their own perspective, it's not allowed. So the bank should return the hamis jidiyah to the customer. But of course, what are the point of applying hamis jidiyah if the money has to be returned to the customer? That's why if I maybe we could check again, because I it's quite a long time for me not reviewing this seeing this fatwa. If I'm not mistaken, in based on the IYC, they're allowed to hamis jidiyah for the Islamic bank to take some amount of hamis jidiyah or urbun or the down payment, but up to real losses that they experience by themselves, okay? But up to the real loss that they that occurs. And for the collateral, yes, it's true. Many people say that Islamic Bank is not supposed to require collateral for the customer. But when we go back to the fatwa, especially issued in Indonesia by the National Syariah Council, they mention clearly there is no prohibitions for Islamic Bank to require collateral from the client. Okay, there's no prohibition. So it may or may not. If the bank doesn't want to require collateral, it's fine because we have a lot of uncollateral financing as well. But if they want collateral, it's also no problem because there's no clear prohibition in the Sharia that when we give a financing that the bank, that the client have to provide collateral. But the issues may become for the we can find a big the issue in the mudarabah and musyarakah financing. Because when we take a venture with someone, when we do a business together with someone, it's quite strange when we require them to provide us the collateral. But again, from the maslahah point of view, the National Council of Ulama in Indonesia allow Islamic Bank to require collateral from the mudarabah or musyarakah partner, but the bank is only allowed to take the collateral if the losses of the ventures are due to the misconduct and negligence and breach of the contract of the client, not of because of the general losses. So there are some restriction provided by the ulama there when the Islamic Bank can take the collateral due to the losses. I think that's my response, Brother Seku.
Yeah, Doctor, thank you. I got your response and then they are well detailed and understood. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. So, Bu Lilis, is there any more questions?
Moderator, you let me to ask something to you? Pak Ronald?
Yeah, yeah, boleh, boleh.
Yeah, okay. Yes. Yeah, you work in LPS, right?
Yes.
Yeah, in Lembaga Penjamin Simpanan. How you claim that Syariah Banking have the facing the systematic or not systematic risk?
Ah.
Yeah.
Okay. So basically in Indonesia, yeah, the systemic or non-systemic risk is not determined by the LPS. It's the OJK. Yes.
Yeah. But OJK, you are at the jaring, at the third jaring, at the
KSSK, financial safety net. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes. And you will take the decision. This bank will liquidate or not? Because this bank faced the specific the problem risk or the unsystematic risk.
Yes, yeah, but yeah, that's true. But in the FSN, we call it in English the FSN, financial safety net. The decision of those who responsible to determine whether bank is systemic or not in is OJK together, yeah, with the Bank Indonesia. They use we refer to the Basel for the FSB or Basel, I can't remember. It depends on the asset complex asset. How could I forget? There are four categories: asset complexity, and then substitutability and interconnectedness. If I'm not mistaken, yes.
Okay.
But somehow it's maybe asset is a using the asset is the easiest one. You can just check how most of the maybe 10, 15, 20 banks, I'm not sure because it's the name of the bank is a secret. Even me myself, I don't have the real info because I'm not in charge directly to that part. Okay, but the easiest one is just look to, from the size. Although somehow I know some banks who are big enough are still not under the category as the systemic bank. Maybe because the business are not that complex, or maybe because they do not interconnected with others. But up until now, up to the extent of my knowledge, of course, there are no Islamic bank yet classified as systemic banks.
Yeah.
The biggest Islamic bank that we have is Bank Syariah Mandiri. If I'm not mistaken, BSM is number 16 in terms of asset, right? But the business, because they are Islamic bank, the business are still not complex, and they are interconnected, but only with the Islamic banks, in Islamic banking industry only, and Islamic banking industry in total is just less than 6%. That's why they are not categorized as systemic banks. But of course, our vice president yesterday announced that in 2020, these three banks, Islamic banks on by the BUMN, they will merge into one bank. It will be a very big banks. I believe that these banks will be a systemic bank.
Okay. Yeah. As the part of the safety net in the financial system, then LPS if LPS decision that the certain bank will not liquidate but will continue this operational, and then you give this problem to the SSK, right? Yeah. You including in the management what the type of decision in the SSK for to make this this bank
diselamatkan tidak diselamatkan, yes, itu namanya. Actually we only go to KSSK only for the systemic bank. For non-systemic bank, LPS has to decide which resolution option that they need to take. Okay, we have based on LPS law, we have two options for resolutions.
Yeah.
First is liquidation. Second one is open bank assistance. The one that we did with the Bank Century is open bank assistance. So we inject the capital to the bank, and then after a few years, we sell the bank to the market. Okay, that's the two option, resolution option mandated by the LPS law. But according to a new law, Undang-Undang PPKSK, the Financial Safety Net Act, LPS was given another two options called as purchase and assumption, as well as bridge banks. But this option actually same, in which liabilities, especially insured deposit of the banks, of the failed bank, will be transferred to another bank, together with the good asset of the bank. Okay, but the bad asset of the bank will be liquidated. The main difference is with the PNA, the good asset and the insured deposit will be transferred to the existing bank, but for the bridge bank, the good asset and the liability will be transferred to a new bank established by the LPS itself, and it will be sold later on after the process. And why we use bridge bank instead of existing bank or the purchase and an assumption? Because somehow maybe we cannot find the right buyer at the right time. That's why we establish a new bank. We call it as a temporary bank or a bridge bank. That's why this approach called as that bridge bank. Now we are in the process of studying to decide which resolution option that we use, we conduct what's called as least cost test, which option that provide least cost to us, to the LPS. So we determine the resolution option based on the least cost test. Based on the new law, due to the COVID, the government put another criteria to determine the resolution options. It's not only the based on the least cost criteria, but also based on another four criteria. I can't remember in detail, but one of them are complexity, and then I can't remember, but it's the complexity there, and then for potential impact to the economy, there's something that have to be reconsider as well in determining the resolution options. And of course, to some extent, when we will conduct risk cost test to the Islamic Bank, some of aspect has need to be adjusted. Because as we explained earlier, the product of Islamic banks are different. Okay, we have murabah, ijarah, salam, and istisna. Okay, ownership of the clients and the bank in the financing is depend on the akad that it used in the financing itself. So it, later on, it will affect the valuations of the financing. So because it affect the valuation of the financing, it will affect also the calculation of the cost during the resolution. But we are still in the process about that. Then maybe I cannot share anything yet in detail about this method. Okay, Bu Lilis, that's my answer.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you very much. Yeah, this is very interesting because I think that it is not easy to LPS to claim that certain bank will liquidate or not, because the impact of this decision, I think, is very dangerous in our financial industry, right?
No, Bu Lilis. To take decision to liquidate is easy.
Oh, easy?
It's very easy, yes. But to take the decision to rescue or do the open bank assistance, that is the most difficult one.
Oh yeah, I think that's because when LPS decided that a certain bank liquidations, it is will give the big impact in our financial system, right?
It depends on the banks. You know, currently we have liquidated more than 100 banks, including 7 Islamic banks. But of course, the Islamic banks are Islamic rural banks. For the commercial bank, we liquidated one, Bank IFI, if you still remember, back in 2008.
Yeah.
Bank IFI also have Islamic banking windows, and we do open bank assistance for the Bank Century, and this is give a nightmare to us.
Yeah, but when we heard about the Bank Bukopin information about the problem there, this is the image of the people is very bad for our financial industry, right?
I'm not sure. I cannot answer about that. It's quite sensitive, but but actually, Bukopin is still within the we call as a ranah OJK. It's a OJK authority, so we will not comment.
Yeah. Okay, I understand. This is not in your in your field, right? This is not your obligation. Yeah, I think this is in the ranah OJK. Yeah, but the information that's spreading in the people then give the not good image to the our financial industry.
But for the research perspective, we concern about that as well, because somehow if there is a bank failure, especially if the big bank failure, it will trigger a bank run or rush. In that sense, we undertake a study last year. We collaborate with the UGM, with the Gajah Mada. We do a behavioral analysis on the bank run, something like that. It's quite interesting topic. It's kind of experimental method.
What the main factor that influence the bank run by the empirical study?
It's many things. Of course, the first one is the loss of loss of confidence to the banking system.
Yes.
If we go back to the 1998, even at the time we adopt the blanket guarantee, right? 100% of deposit in the bank will be guaranteed by the government. But still, bank run still happened. What happened? Until the bank and the government announced that there is no more bank will be liquidated. So I think this is also the reason why in 2008, maybe, there's an opinion that no banks are not to fail during the global economic turbulence. Global economic turbulence. But of course, it was challenging a lot by many parties, including the parliaments at the time. That's why now, after that, the Ministry of Finance, Bank Indonesia, and OJK come out with a list of systemic banks.
Yeah, especially during the this coronavirus pandemic, I think OJK and also Bank Sentral give the soft regulations.
No comment.
No comment. This is very secret, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. To all participants, you still have the question for Mr. Ronald related to the Syariah banking here? Oh, no responding from the from the participant. Okay. One more from me, Pak Ronald. But I think this is outside the topic today. I want to ask to you about the why the word claim that the best implementation of the Syariah banking even in Switzerland. Why?
Really? I'm not sure about that. Maybe
you don't know about that?
No, maybe the implement of conventional bank, maybe yes, it's Switzerland because they are very prudent. But for Islamic bank, I never hear that. Even I heard quite frequent that people said that implementation of Islamic bank in Indonesia is the best in the world, but somehow I argued about it.
Oh yeah.
Maybe in the past, yes, in the 90s or early 2000s. But you know, I mean, if you look to the practice of Islamic banks in Malaysia, you look the Sharia governance framework. We don't talk about the non-performing financing, okay? We just talk about the how we implement the Sharia governance. I think Malaysia is much better than us in terms of that.
Yeah. Okay. According to you said that Indonesia is better for Syariah implementation. But according to the Syariah instrument that I should buy Central Bank or OJK. But why we face the problem about the we difficult to increase the market share of the Syariah banking? Why?
Okay. It's a lot of people ask this question because
yes.
the answer is easy, Bu Lilis, because we target wrong customers. In LPS, we have a data that we already cover. We guarantee 99.9% of banking accounts in Indonesia, meaning that 99.9% banking account in Indonesia is less than 2 million rupiah because we guaranteed up to 2 million rupiahs only, right?
Yeah.
But the 99.9% banking accounts in Indonesia is count only up to around 55% of money in the banking industry only. So the rest 45% is owned by the 0.1% customer. So if Islamic bank wanna get bigger, they should tap the 0.1% customer. Who are the 0.1% customer? They are government, state-owned company or BUMN, they are private sectors, and maybe high net worth individuals, okay?
Yeah.
We always say that Indonesia has a good, big potential for Islamic bank because 5% of Indonesians are Muslim.
Yeah.
But I believe the high net worth individual in Indonesia are not Muslim. Okay, let's assume that only 50% of them are Muslim. So for the 55% of the money, okay, of the 55% of the money in the banks, we just divide by 2. Maybe we maximum of Islamic banks in Indonesia, if we only targeted individual Muslim, I believe it's just up to around 20% market share only. That's why Islamic bank has go to the government, that on enterprise, private, they have to service such kind of parties. But the problem is those parties. Although when I was in NKNKS, we are trying to approach them to move the fund to the Sharia. Even the Ministry of Finance has issued regulations that it's allowed to pay salary to the Islamic banks. Only few units that use Islamic bank to pay the salary because they complain that the facilities that they receive are not similar to the conventional ones.
Okay, yeah. Maybe because Syariah banking, the three type of markets. Maybe the small one is a Islamic customer. Have the understanding about the Syariah principle, and when they know that Syariah banking not 1% 100% implemented the Syariah principle, yeah, so the small market one will refuse and will store their money, yeah, under pillow. Yeah. The second market, this is a big market, but this is a rational market, Pak. Yeah, we'll calculate about the profit and loss. What I will got something when I.
Hello.
This is a big market, but this is a rational market. We'll calculate about the profits or not when I using the Syariah banking transaction. If by calculation, the customer will not get profit enough in Syariah banking, so they will go to the conventional. And the third market, this is a small market. Yeah, I think that's Syariah banking not only owned by Muslim, right?
Yeah,
but a non-Muslim can use this banking transaction in Syariah banking. But this is very small, and Syariah banking have to make so understand for this customer until this customer will decide to use the Syariah banking transaction.
Yes, somehow it's a kind of chicken or an egg, because this rational customer, they want better services, cheaper price for the financing, and of course higher profit for the investment or for the deposit. Actually, it's very capitalist, you know.
but this is a big market.
But the thing is to provide such kind of services, it's very difficult for Islamic bank due to the economic of scale. Of course, it's cheaper to buy to shop to buy something in Carrefour rather than in the mini mart, right? It's same case happened to the Islamic to the banking industry. It's the bigger bank will always be cheaper than the smaller bank, and most of the Islamic bank are smaller banks.
Yeah.
But then if we always put such a mindset, it's quite difficult to grow the Islamic bank. That's why now intervention for the government is very important here. This is what we wait, actually, what kind of intervention that will be do by the government. And one of the initiative that are sure for now, hopefully, is the merge of these three big government state-owned enterprise-owned Islamic banks.
But there is no Islamic bank in Indonesia that's owned by the government, right?
Not yet.
Yeah, all Syariah banking is private banking.
Yeah, although three of them owned by the state-owned enterprise.
Yeah, why not become the state bank?
State bank, because if the government will want to inject the money to the banks, they should get approval from the parliament.
Yes, I know. So in Malaysia, why rapid growth very well over there? Because I think that's all the Syariah banking over there owned by the state.
No. Same actually. Same. They don't have the government do not own the Syariah banks. They own the Maybank, CIMB. CIMB have the Maybank Islamic, CIMB Islamic. But the thing is, they adopt different system in which actually although Maybank have Maybank Islamic, CIMB have CIMB Islamic, the business are still the same, you know. The business are still the same. Yes, from the legal perspective they are different entity, but from the business perspective they are one. So the parents bank can offer the Islamic banking services. You know, until last year, 60% of Maybank portfolio, Maybank is the biggest bank in Malaysia.
In Malaysia.
And one of the biggest bank in Southeast Asia. Yes. But 60% of the Maybank portfolio are Islamic. Mm. Can you imagine that?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, now, maybe there are a backup from the government is very good for the Islamic Islamic banking will raise in Malaysia.
Yes, because government first they support Islamic bank, they give incentive. Okay, so Islamic bank will be cheaper and Islamic bank will provide high return as to compared to the conventional bank. Second, the is the government put the money into the Islamic bank as well. That's why. And the third one, actually this third one, we OJK actually follow the Malaysian step. They introduce so-called as POJK about synergy, if I'm not mistaken, in which the parent banks can sell the product of the Islamic bank.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, hopefully in the future, Syariah Bank Indonesia will rapid growth like in Malaysia. And hopefully also that support from the government is very good. Yeah. Okay, maybe to all the participants, while our discussion with Pak Ronald, you have any question here? Yeah, okay. I think there is no question anymore, Pak Ronald. Yes, and we already concern 2 hours to our discussion about the Syariah banking, because it is a very interesting discussion about the Syariah banking in Indonesia, especially. Because there are no question from the participants, so I think we will ending this meeting. Let's we close this lesson today by alhamdulillah together.
Alhamdulillah
rabbil alamin. See you next, Pak Ronald. in different topic of discussion. Maybe someday we will meet again with the LPS topic. especially on Syariah banking. How you cover the deposits, calculate about the premi, that will paid by the bank Syariah banking customer, with the conventional bank, I think it is not difficult to understanding, but how about the Syariah banking, because we based on contract, and not interest. Okay. Right. Pak Ronald, thank you very much. I will close by assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Makasih Bu Lili.
Thank you very much to all participants today. Remain keep the healthy, using masker and face shield. Everywhere we find the someone. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye.
Paradigma pendidikan kami adalah memberi peluang bagi yang ingin berusaha untuk maju dan meraih kemandirian dengan penguasaan ilmu dan teknologi secara kreatif, inovatif, dinamis, dan berakhlakul karimah. institusi kami menjadi sebuah universitas yang unggul dalam pengembangan ilmu dan teknologi dengan berlandaskan nilai-nilai Islam untuk kemaslahatan umat.
Universitas